Good evening, everyone, and welcome back to a brand new season of the program you've been waiting for, which is To The Point. Last season, we had a lot to talk about, and this season is going to be more interesting. To The Point is back here every Wednesday night. Make sure to tune in. But tonight, we are going to focus on one thing and one thing only: social media and the kids. 3/4 of children aged between 10 and 12 have social media accounts, despite being below the age limit. A majority of 10 to 12 years old use social media, despite being below the age limit to have an account. A survey have revealed that social media services like Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and Snapchat requires an account holder to be at least 13 years old. But a survey by the BBC News program for Children News Round found that more than 3/4 of young children at primarily leaving the age were using at least one social media network. However, 13 to 18 years old, 96% uses social media networks. The most popular site for the under 13 years old was Facebook, which 49% said they used. A survey of 13 to 18 years old found 24% reported that they were targeted on the internet because of their gender, sexual orientation, race, religion, disability, or transgender identity. How can you as a parent help your children stay protected online? How can you protect your kids from abuse through the internet? All of most of the time, researchers revealed that more than 4 in 5, 82% of them, about 1,500 youngsters, polled said they had seen or heard online hate in the previous 12 months. In fact, 89% of teens aged 13 to 17, according to the researchers, reported using at least one social media site, and 71% reported use of more than one site. Did you know that just about every social media site allows users to sign up when they search 13 years old age? That's incredible. Your child friends are on the website talking about media. They saw on the website sharing their experiences and stories on the website. The happening stuff is happening online, and kids want to be part of it. Can we monitor what and how for how long? Is it safe or is it a violation of privacy? This is all of that, and we will decide what exactly we need to talk about this in this program, To The Point. Stick around, because we have all the guests that they are going to talk about this, so don't go anywhere.
So much of parents' fear around social media use comes from this fear that their kids' lives will be ruined forever. And we see that a lot of times online, where people make poor decisions and then their lives are affected in pretty dramatic ways. But I think it's important to step back with kids and help them understand, how can you be more intentional about how you're spending your time online, and how can you align those with your values? The smartphone was only really released about 10 or 12 years ago. So all these apps are new for parents as well. Kids are going through some treacherous terrain when it comes to technology and social media use. But we also need to understand that they're using technology for some positive things: learning, understanding, communicating. So when we do that, we become more open to helping kids in an objective way that protects them from some of the detrimental, draining, and dangerous things that may happen online or in real life. So where do I start? What do I do? The first is this idea of developing awareness. Learn what apps your kids are using, learn how to use them, download them on your phone, and then you can come from a framework that's more objective rather than coming from a place of fear and telling kids they can never use something. The second thing is creating opportunities for daily and weekly digital detox. Taking kids' phones and devices away at night can be a really easy way to do this. And a lot of times kids will tell me, I don't want to tell my parents this, but but I'm really grateful that they take my phone away at night, because then I can tell my friends I'm not available after a certain hour. Otherwise, it becomes this feeling of always online, always having to react. And kids don't want that either, but they don't really know how to effectively self-regulate. And the third thing is helping kids figure out their why. Why you're reaching for your phone, or why you're posting, or why you're taking so many photos when you're with friends. The idea is really to help kids identify and understand what is energizing for them and what is draining. They have a choice in how they spend their time online. They can opt into experiences and opt out. And that's a really empowering message. And once they're given permission and understanding that they have choices, they actually start making really good ones that are in line with their own personal values.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. Just for those of you who just joined us, this is To The Point, and we are here every Wednesday night, and we are going to talk about the juveniles, the children, and the social media. Guess what? Kuwait General Prosecutor Dirar Al-Asrousi has ordered for strict guidelines to ensure that children are adequately protected from the potential dangers of social media, prepared by the Supreme National Committee for Kids Protection, collaboration with the Juvenile Prosecution Department. The guidelines had involved several terms that legitimized the use of social media by children, strictly prohibited elders' exploitation of children, which reflects negatively upon them, and a lot more. Guess what? We have two distinguished lawyers, and they are in our studio. We have number one here, lawyer Jumana. This is misprinted here, but it's all right. Jumana Bahbahani. She is the head of International Legal Organization Committee at the Kuwait Bar Association. And also we have another lawyer, and her name is Lina Adlouni. She's a legal consultant and a lawyer. Welcome to the program. Well, this is our debut in the studio. And this is a very pivotal situation. We have youngsters dealing with phones, mobiles, tablets, and everything they can get their hands on to get interact with social media, such as Instagram, Twitter, Snapchat, Facebook, and etc. But first, we are going to start with you, Mrs. Jumana. First of all, let us talk a little bit about the youngsters and their playing with the phone by using the social media. What is your perspective about this situation?
Well, first of all, it's a pleasure to be with you today. This is a very critical situation here. We have teenagers and children less than the prohibited age. Having phones, tablets, laptops. You see a child like he's still in kindergarten and he has his own phone or his own tablet, and you don't know what he or she is watching, and this is very critical.
So you think that there is a kind of a negative impact on the kids in general when they use the social media because they are not old enough to understand what's going on in real life? So it might be harmful for them in the present time.
Yes, there are several negative impacts on children and adults, let alone children, because it's not the age, it's the awareness of using such social media, such applications, such websites. I'm gonna just point out using how social media affects people, children or adults. Mm-hmm. I'm going to sum it up because there are several negative points. I'm going to say what's important. First of all, there is a phenomenon called fear of missing out, FOMO. What is fear of missing out? It's the anxiety you get when you are scared of missing out a positive experience. Like what's going on? There is something going on around me, and I don't know what's that. Let's see Snapchat. Let's see Instagram. Okay, let's leave Instagram and go to Twitter. You see all the people are going from each application to another one, so he doesn't miss out. It is the more you use social media networks, the more likely you are to see that someone is having more fun than you, which is not true, but this is the phenomenon called FOMO.
That's unfortunate.
Yeah.
Mrs. Adlouni. The general prosecutor, Dirar Al-Asrousi, has issued a decree. Let's make it, it's not a decree, it's something like a guideline of using the social media, specifically for kids. And the point is that he wants to protect them from the bad people who are just waiting for them to go online and try to harm them in any way he can or she can. Your thought about this situation, do you agree or not? Do you think that we need to do more and more to protect our kids online?
Right. Thank you for hosting us. And indeed, such guidelines that were issued, they were issued on, based on the children rights law, which is recently issued back in 2015. And it was as well derived from and based from the Convention of the Protecting of the Child Child Rights. When such guidelines issued, they have taken into consideration the protection of the child. And these guidelines were 9 guidelines to aware the people, to aware the society, and to protect the child. Definitely awareness for society and for the child itself, himself or herself, is very important, because the space now is very open, and legally that the child or the even the juvenile are not aware of their rights and their responsibilities and liabilities. When we say that such laws are issued to protect them, it is at the same time to protect and to prevent crimes that would happen. And as we can see the progress of the social media and the internet, and such a space, cyber security issues are all developing in so fast and cannot just limit.
They cannot keep up. Cannot the protection, I don't think it's enough
it
for them, because
exactly.
No matter what you do, the other side is smarter and they do the other things that you might neglect to do that.
Right.
Now, Mrs. Bahbahani, I would love from you to tell us about the scientific and moral legal foundation for this guidelines by Dirar Al-Asrousi.
For the age limit, you see.
That's correct.
Okay. Scientifically, the age of 13, where you where the children reach puberty, in which the child should know how to differentiate between right and wrong. It's the beginning of their teens, 13. Okay, child law has this age that the child could be listened to and taken, and his words taken for granted, you know.
Now, let's go back to Mrs. Lena Adlouni. There are some kind of commercial guidelines, and
right.
also there are some kind of stuff they insert them online for the kids to get attracted by it.
True.
And I believe that these things are going to the negative side opposed to the positive side. What do you think?
Of course. When the child is having the floor and having the liberty to use such websites or tablets or iPads or even the mobile, the child is not assessing the consequences, whereas if he is logging into any website that is not limited within kind of security, then he will be having the chance and opportunity to view things that is not improper. So the guidelines of the Geneville prosecution, when they organized such regulation, it has regulated like 9 awareness issues. And one of them is the age that such is applicable to the child who is at the least the 13 years old. When Ms. Bahbahani as well explained the 13 years old for puberty, it is true, because even if we look at the labor law, the limit age is 15 that you can hire a labor. So imagine the maturity wise, if he is really now, he is mature to work. So if he wants to work, a child is a Geneviève, then he will help the responsibility to perform the work that will be assigned to it. And by the way, the labor law has even reduced the hours, working hours. It's not like any labor that's 18 hours, but the 6 hours.
That's for the adults. We're talking about the children. It's a different story. And now let's go back to Mrs. Bahbahani. Psychological exploitation. That's a big word.
Yes.
Because it will affect the person, specifically if he or she is young, and it might build up when he or she gets older and older. And this is the age where we need to step in and to protect them. Your elaboration.
Okay. First of all, psychologically, it build up from a younger age. So that's why it's stated in the act that it is not allowed to abuse a child's dignity or humiliate him through posting funny or embarrassing images or videos that can create a scene of mockery, offense them, whether religiously, morally, literally, or socially. Not that alone, also it prohibited improper or offensive or sarcastic comments on the images of a post for a child. And so not only the act post talks about posting stuff or putting stuff on the social media, it also speaks to the commenting from other people.
That's a pitiful thing to say, honestly, to comment. Yeah, I can imagine when you're talking about this situation, I'm imagining the person, young person, like he or she is going to be affected, and to shape up the personality that he or she is going to become in the future. Now, Mrs. Lena Adlouni, there are some footage that they installed them inside the internet. And it could be sexual, or it could be violence, or it could be something else. And he or she is going to adapt this footage and put it in their minds. Now, regarding the legal approach to this, what exactly the legality of this situation?
Definitely, limits should be done and should be set up by the parents for their child not to use and to limit such use. Our guidelines that has issued was did not stipulate penalties. Penalties were because it is based such guidelines when issued, it was based on the child law that was issued in 2015. So there are penalties in the children for abusing them. It goes far to imprisonment and as well for a fine for thousands of.
That takes us to the mechanism of the guidelines, which was declared by the Lara Asusi. Tell us about this, the mechanism. What exactly it deals with?
Okay. First of all, we need to know, our viewers need to know that we have child care centers.
And they are scattered all over the state of Kuwait?
Yes. Each province has a child care center. It was legalized, established in 2015, where it was legalized by the child rule that was put in December 2015. Okay. Each province has a child care center, and there's numbers you can contact them to say to call them, and if any breach happens, considering the child law, they will take action.
They do.
Yes.
and they have to bring their own parents. They cannot the child by himself go and file a report or something like that.
No, anybody can file a report. Uh-huh. If they know there is an abuse, uh-huh. you just call them and they can file
like
a report.
Like the Good Samaritan, you can go there and file there is a child abuse yes. somewhere in the state of Kuwait.
The Kuwait. Neighbors, cousins, anybody.
Mm. Custodian. If custodian as well, the parent custodians uh-huh. and whoever he is living with in such care.
Okay, final word from you, Mrs. Mm-hmm. Adlouni. Mm-hmm. If you were the Darar Asosi, what exactly you could add to the guidelines in your mind? What exactly you need to do more or maybe less?
Right. So I would put the penalties mm-hmm. to aware the society that our guidelines is based on laws, based on convention of UN, based on the committee as well that was formed for the implementation of such guidelines. However, as well, it is very important for the society to be aware that any act that harm the child is not allowed. Even if it is using for advertising, in advertising, or using the services, or using even the child itself must be under care. And this is the responsibility of parents, school, and all the their related parties who are indeed caring for such precious children.
I believe you have something to say before we sum up the whole thing.
Yes.
Okay, go ahead, please.
First of all, the guidelines, I'm going to read the...
But quickly, because we are almost out of time.
Yes. It says the minimum age limit for using social media websites. Okay, here it states only the websites. We have applications. It did not state it in the guidelines.
Such as application regarding what? What do you
it
mean
says
by
here, social media websites, uh-huh. okay? Websites, you go on web browser. Now, in the phone, it's applications. Snapchat is an application.
Else. Yeah. So there is a leaphole. Something
yes,
is
there is a loophole. Uh-huh. That's what I wanted to point out.
Well, this is wonderful to know.
Yeah.
So if I'm a bad guy, I can insert myself in the loophole this way.
Yes, because, you know, Snapchat, Twitter, Instagram, they're all applications. They're not websites. Well. They have websites on the web. You can browse them.
You need to do something about it.
Yeah, true.
Well, folks, we would like to thank our two guests for the first episode right here tonight. We had lawyer Jumana Bahbahani, head of the International Legal Organization Committee at the Kuwait Bar Association, and also Lina Adlouni. She's a lawyer and legal consultant. Don't go away, we have more of that. We have another report regarding the people in the street and all over the state of Kuwait. They're giving their thoughts with our colleague, Rania Al-Sabah.
Hello to our dear viewers. So this afternoon we're in one of the shopping centers of the state of Kuwait. And we're here because we want to ask individuals what they think of children under the age of 13 using the internet and social media. We ask this question because the internet, social media, technology, gadgets, mobile gadgets have found their way into every home and to the hands of children as young as 1 year of age. Because of that, we want to ask what people think, whether they want to restrict it, whether they want to monitor it, or whether they want to prohibit children from using it altogether. So now, let's go around and find out. So Dunya, tell us what you think of children under the age of 13 using the internet and social media.
Okay, I think that it shouldn't be restricted. They shouldn't be moved away from that because now we have it and I don't think we will ever be without it. So we have to get used to them using it. But I think it should be controlled. So I think parents should be there as a guidance, what to use, how to use it. And I think they need to show them how to use it in a good way. So I think it needs to be controlled, but not like forbidden for them.
Well, first of all, I think the internet is a beautiful, useful place where you can learn a lot of things, but at the same time, it's a dangerous and nasty place. So yes, children under 13, even I think over the age of 13, should be monitored using the internet, especially social medias like Facebook or Twitter, Instagram, even YouTube. And that's about it, because we all heard about nasty cases of mistreatments and cyberbullying, which is quite actual these days. And yes, I think it should be monitored, even over the age of 13.
Ali, hello, how are you?
I am so good.
Ali, tell us, do you watch videos on YouTube?
Yes.
What do you like to watch, cartoons or people?
People.
And what do the people do? What are the videos like?
They like play and like do challenges.
And why do you watch these? Do you think they're fun or do you copy them?
I like it because it's like so funny and happy and like so exciting to like feel what they're feeling.
Do you use a phone? Do you play on a phone?
I don't have a phone.
Maybe your mom's phone or your brother's phone?
No, I use my iPad.
And what do you do on your iPad?
I watch videos and play.
I think, first of all, it's good. It's a good way for them to broaden their horizon. And the better effect is that they can find everything from the social media, which is not negative, I think, yeah.
So what do you think the solution to that is? Do you think they should be monitored, websites should be blocked away from them, or their parents just monitor them?
I think it's difficult for the parents to monitor them. If there's some filter function, it's better from the website, yeah.
So that's the solution you think, the government should intervene?
Yeah, in my opinion.
Hi, Jenna, so tell us, how old are you?
I'm 12.
And are you often on social media or the internet?
I'm often on it, but there's a problem with social media that it's anyone can contact it and anyone can hack it. So anyone can get hacked, and if they have personal information on Instagram or on Facebook that they don't want anyone to see, it's easily hacked. So that's a big problem now.
So are you worried about being hacked? Has anything happened to you before?
Nothing's happened to me because my account, I don't have anything private on it. So I don't actually care if anyone hacks me. They're free to do that. But it is a problem now because a lot of people, they do have like personal information, their bank account and stuff like that. They can get hacked and they can get into a big trouble.
So what else do you do online other than using social media? Do you watch YouTube videos? Do you browse the internet?
I don't browse the internet a lot because there's nothing I need to search except for like homework stuff. I usually sit and talk with my friends on WhatsApp. Like school stuff, that's it.
And on your phone, how many hours do you think you spend on it per day?
24 hours.
24 hours, your parents don't mind?
They mind. I stop for 1 or 2 hours. I just sit and talk.
Welcome back. Age restrictions on social media platforms are in place to keep kids safe. Unfortunately, violating these restrictions is simply uneasy when young kids falsify their age and use social media. They are often too young to understand the implication of their post or effectively handle dangerous situations and cannot be protected by the laws directed at the safety of youth online. Luckily, parental control software is a proven method to restricting monitoring your children's access to social media until they are responsible and ready to do that. Let us welcome our next two guests, and they are as much as distinguished as the others. We have on the left side, she's a well-known by her father, Shafiq Al-Ghabra. He's a doctor. He's a PhD in the Kuwait University. We'd like to welcome Dr. Hanin Al-Ghabra. Yes. She is from the Kuwait University in the Mass Communication Department. And also we have with us here Madame Jawahar Abu Aish. She is from CCET. I did not want to know off the air. I want to know it on the air right now. What exactly we're talking about, CCET?
It's a Center for Child Evaluation and Teaching. It's a school for children who have learning difficulties.
We can still learn from here, from Jawahar. What do you think?
I think, yeah, we
should.
We are
all children of the world.
Exactly.
Now we are talking to Dr. Hen. Let me start with you, Dr. Al-Ghabra, since you are from the Mass Communication Kuwait University. Mm-hmm. We're talking about the social media and the children under the age are using it widely. And there is no limitation for them. Your perspective before we enter into the questions right here.
Well, my perspective is it's not black and white.
Uh-huh.
Social media is just a newer form of media that has not replaced, but enhanced older forms of traditional media like television and radio and all these other forms. So I think as harmful as the harmful aspects that we see in TV and we see in the radio are also, mm-hmm. we're also going to find in mm-hmm. social media.
You need to
and
say.
So I need to write. I know I have
because
this.
Because you get excited like this and everybody
like
gets
I
excited
talk.
With you.
I want to talk, yeah.
I know. This is a pivotal situation.
Right? Exactly pivotal. The chair is pivoting.
I know.
But so what I'm trying to say is that it's not black or white. So if we have a law on social media, we need to basically fine tune and figure out how we're going to implement it. The execution is what's going to be beneficial or non-beneficial.
Mm. Now, let's take it from the psychological and the social thing from your perspective, Mrs. Jawahar. You think that the children in the world, we're not talking about only in the state of Kuwait, are being mishandled when they use the social media under the age of 13. What exactly we need to do?
First of all, they're not supposed to be on social media at that age, but let's, like you said in the introduction, let's face it, they're already on social media.
No, you cannot control it.
Yeah, so it's better for us to be one step ahead and instead of telling them, oh, you're not allowed to be on social media, not giving them the tools necessary for them to protect themselves, we should tell them, okay, look, I know you're going to hear about this, I know you're going to be on social media, so this is what you need to know. So I think that should be our approach.
I have kids, and everybody who is watching us right now, they have kids, and they have their phones in their hands. And it breaks your heart to take the phone
it
from
does.
Them and to restrict them on one thing only, to watch cartoons or probably watch something more parental guidance in it. But somehow, somewhere, they are going to sneak up and do the thing that you rarely control it. What exactly we need to do to prevent this from happening?
I think if you set guidelines at home and you have certain limits and they're supposed to have not more than 2 hours a day of screen time, whether that's TV, iPads, laptops, everything. So I think if you have these guidelines at home and you say, okay, you can do whatever you want to do according to our rules during this time. And then after this time, we can have a certain activity that we agree on together that we can engage in. But if you give them a bit of what they want with what you want together, it's easier to control it.
Dr. Al-Ghabra, I guess that there are things that we need to take more precautions when we're talking about the kids and the Instagram and Twitter and stuff like that. Sometimes they install some things that us as adults, we hate to see it. We're talking about here the inappropriate advertising. Sometimes they put advertisement that it's kind of, below the moral standard. Mm-hmm. What exactly we need to do to prevent this from happening?
Well, I know that they took down a bunch of accounts. Now, so I have a colleague mm-hmm. who did an assignment where they did an analysis of the comments on child fashionistas on Instagram. So they did an analysis of all the comments.
They have kids now,
Kid fashionistas. So you have like kids that are like 10 or 11 years old.
This is exploitation.
And they're teaching exploitation. They're teaching other kids how to wear makeup, so you have like this privilege of like.
And at the age of what?
10, 11, 12. So we're teaching these kids that you have to wear makeup and beauty is the thing you have to strive for, right? So we're teaching them these shallow things. We're not teaching them things that are more in depth. And the problem is when she did this analysis, my colleague, all the comments were very harmful. Comments that if we were to read at our age about us, if we were, let's say, these social media child celebrities, we would be completely shattered from how harmful the comments were to a kid so young, 10 and 11 and 12 years old.
I'm speechless, honestly. I am really speechless. That's where you come in and hear the situation and try to put some guidelines for parents not to let them be so, have big latitude for them to do whatever they want to do.
Yeah.
So as a parent, what exactly you need to do to prevent these advertisements from going inside the head of the children?
Obviously, they're going to see it. If they're not going to see it, they're going to hear about it from their friends. So I think if we have an open conversation with our children and tell them what's okay and what's not, making them aware and telling them how we can, you know, relay a positive message or a positive image across these social media platforms and how we can fight back against this image that you were talking about. So I think having an open conversation instead of just trying to hide it from them, because they're curious and they're kids and they're going to look it up, whether it's at school or in a friend's house, it's exposed already. So I think you need to have an open conversation with them, and that's the best way.
Mm-hmm. Hold this thought, because we have a phone call right this moment, and it is from Isa Al-Dafir. He's a 7 years medical student. Good evening, sir, and welcome to the program.
Good evening.
Sir, you have been listening to us and talking about the social media in the state of Kuwait and around the world and regarding the kids who are misusing it. What's your thoughts regarding this situation? What exactly we need to do as parents to prevent these kids from being affected negatively?
All right. The main issue now with social media is it's being used every day and in every aspect of our life. As you know, now it's not just a form of entertainment or communication. It's even used in schools and everyday life as a form of education as well. It's where we share information and all of that. Now, the issue with restraining children is that it must be done as they don't have the proper judgment to limit themselves. Usually they get carried away, usually from their peers or from their own interests and indulgences. They would like to binge on these social media platforms. The main issues that we fear are, number one, which is the most common, is corneal dryness. They have dry eyes most of the time, and it's a big issue in kids these days. Another issue usually they have neck pain as well from bending down and looking at these screens. The thing is, as you tilt your neck, the pressure and the weight of the neck on your spine actually increases up to 4 times the actual weight of your head, which causes severe strain on the neck. So these issues must be taken into consideration in order to restrain them. Now, what happens after we restrain them is sometimes these children become irritable, they become angry, and some of them might even go on some form of strike, as you could say, and they revolt against their parents either by going into solitary confinement. It's not solitary confinement, but actually they stay by themselves and they lack interest in daily activities. They haven't been exposed to the world as they know it, and they've been used to having their phones all the time, which is a big issue.
Mr. Al-Dafiri, I think it's easier than said to do the thing that you have said. But you might have some kind of difficulties to control the situation from your point of view as a doctor, prospective doctor in the future. What exactly you recommend for the parents to do in order for them to prevent these symptoms that you have mentioned?
The main way to tackle this, in my personal view, is never to go directly against the child, especially around age 13. Roughly, they're starting their teenage lives and they're forming their identity, and usually they can't take no for an answer. So the best way is to have some form of closure between you and your child, and then form a sort of a plan on when to use the phones, when it's okay, and when not to use it. And also, we need to know what they're doing on these phones at the same time. And then work a reward system. This is the best way to go. Reward is better than punishment, always.
Mr. Al-Dafiri, thank you so much. I appreciate your thoughts and looking forward to talk to you in the future. Let's go back now to our distinguished guest in the studio. Let's go back to Mrs. Al-Ghabra. I think that we were concentrating on the negative side. Let's talk about a little bit of the positive side. When a young child, around the age of 13, 14 years old, trying to improve his or her life. Do you agree about this or not? You don't.
Wait, I don't understand your question. So
you mean, like, if you imitate somebody else, it might improve your life. And it may be, it might disrupt the growth of your life positively. So do you think that we need to let the youngsters to be, you know, more open to the social media with restriction or not?
Well, the way I see it with any sort of medium, not even social media, but every medium, is just to teach the parents, not only the children, social media literacy. What do I mean by that is that basically, first of all, what does it mean when we're watching something harmful? How do we make the child know that this is not real, that this is not harmful, that this is not how the world is? Because the problem now with most of the social media sites is they're teaching very harmful things, but there's also positive things. It's not black and white. So I feel like even the law that was passed, it's a positive step in terms of exploiting children, right? Because it says exploiting children for fame, for example. But then it goes down to prosecution. So if we're going to prosecute parents and say you're exploiting your children, what does exploitation mean? Before any of these laws come out, we need
you have to have a definition.
Definition
for it.
Exactly. What does exploitation mean? You could, as a father, put a picture of your daughter, and that's not exploitation. But someone might say this is exploitation. So there's a dark side to it also. There's
this
a gray
is
area.
Where Mrs. Abu Aish comes in, because she is specializing in children. Now, she has a very good point. You need to define exploitation before you punish the person himself.
Yeah.
Now, in your point of view, what about the habits? You need to have habits. Now, we have habits in the studios, we have habits in our cars. We need to have social media habits.
I think because kids are like sponges, they learn and
they
imitate
everything
that the parents do. So if the parents have good social media habits, the kids are more likely to learn from their parents. Mm-hmm. And if the parents, for example, follow good examples or good influencers on social media, their kids are more likely to hear about them.
So we need to be
them.
Role models
exactly.
for them.
You need to practice what you preach. You can't tell your kid not to do something and turn around and do it. It's just, for you, even as an adult, yeah, it's a contradiction. You're not going to believe someone who tells you this is harmful for you and still does it, especially if it's your role model, your dad, your mom, someone you look up to.
But doesn't it break your heart when your child wants to play with the phone? I'm not going to say go inside the social media. But somehow, somewhere, you trying to protect him or her from the phone. So how can you break to him or her easily? Like this one, it might affect you in a negative way. Now, how can you break it to him easily?
You need to be honest. You need to tell them you can't just say no. You need to tell them why you're saying no. And you need to give them alternatives. Kids these days don't play. They don't play like we used to.
No.
So you need to teach them. They need to grow up with this. You can't have a teenager and all of a sudden you're like, okay, listen, you can't use your phone anymore, we have rules. And they didn't grow up with these rules, or they didn't have a system that they got used to growing up. So you can't just all of a sudden come in and say, no, you can't use this and take it away. You need to be gradual about the process and you need to give them alternatives.
Dr. Al-Ghabra, since you are a doctor academically, do you think that we need to teach these things in schools? How
yes.
to protect the children from the social media?
For sure. I mean, I don't think it's more protection more than it's being aware, because I feel like the child could even watch a television show and have been exposed, like if you watch Disney, be exposed to the most harmful effects, right? And so I feel like not only do we need to teach it, we need to train them. Not only in college, I already do it in college in my classes, but also in high school, in elementary. How can you be critical? How can you know what's harmful for you and what's not harmful for you? Because this also affects their self-esteem, right? So with young girls, it's like, how should I be more beautiful? I mean, there's, I think, a social media, I can't remember her name. Her name, I think, is Lujain. And she's 10 years old, and she's teaching young girls how to put makeup on. And if you actually go and Google her, it looks very disturbing and very scary. Mm. And if that's what we're teaching young girls, then where's the future, right?
This is your field. This is mass communication. Yeah. We did not see this coming, honestly. To have social media in this time and this era, it's kind of a revolution, isn't it?
It is a revolution, but it's a double-edged sword. It can be a place to cause momentum and have freedom of speech, but it can also be a place of restriction.
Make sure to come back again. I know that this is not the first, and it's not going to be the last. And you,
thank you
for
having me.
You're more than welcome to come back anytime to talk about the same thing.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, we'd like to honestly thank Dr. Haneen Al-Ghabra. She's a mass communication at Kuwait University. And also Madame Jawahar Abu Aish. She is from CCCET, correct?
Yeah, CCET.
Now, unfortunately, it is sad for me to tell you that all the news that we have for you and all the entertainment that we gave you for this evening. Make sure to join us once again next Wednesday at 8:45. With a different topic. Next time it's going to be all about the customs in the state of Kuwait, what you need to know, what exactly these people are trying to do at the airport, the sea and the land and everything else that it matters in this situation. Until I see you again, take care of yourself and each other, and make sure to join us once again Wednesday night, 8:45, right here on KTV2. I'm Ahmed Al-Wasmi. Good night.